All right. So according to the syllabus, we're supposed to be doing group selection today. But I wasn't happy with my lecture. I want more time to get it better. So we moved up the other things. So we're doing systematics right now. Okay. Systematics is the organizing of life. Okay, by taxonomists. Okay. This is something that's happening now. So here's something from our department webpage last year about a new species found. by people here in Chattanooga, in Austin Peay, right? So something, clematis. I mean, you can go out and, buy clematis vines for your yard, right? And even so, grad students here, gotta describe new species. Okay? This is happening all the time. Okay. So, actually, we talked about this a little bit with phylogenetics, right? But what is a species? We discovered a new species. Well, what does that mean? So it could be, a copy was discovered, right? So when it's related to a giraffe, it's very different from a giraffe. So it's definitely like a new thing no one has seen before, right? The other example, though, was something that was previously grouped into some other group and then split. So we thought we had one species, actually we have two species, okay? Both those kinds are called discovering new species. And there's many ways to define a species, right? So we talked about biological species concept, right? Groups that are natural populations that we could be isolated from all other such groups and will remain so in the future, okay? There's various ways of clustering things into species. you can look for different lineages that maintains identity. And so biologists love creating new species concepts, and we love fighting about them. Okay. And so there's lots of arguments in the literature about what a species concept is, what we should use, and that sort of thing. Okay. And one key paper in this area was by Kevin DeKeros in Systematic Biology in 2007, right, where he said, okay, you have all your species criteria. Well, what's the speciation process? Well, basically, you have one lineage that starts dividing into two, and finally you have two independent lineages that can't interbreed anymore. Right? So here they can interbreed, here they can interbreed with these can interbreed with these, and they can't interbreed with each other. Right? And they go off independently through time. And so we have all our criteria we're arguing about. Okay? Do we have diagnosable differences? Do we have no more interbreeding? Is one species monophyletic? Right, so all the individuals in that species have a common ancestor they share before they have a common ancestor with the other species. Are they reproductively incompatible? Right, and his point was that we have these different ways of assessing what the species are. Right, and then you have this path species go through in the speciating. And so what we're arguing about is this gray area. Right? But once we're outside of that gray area, am I the same species as an oak tree? No. And that's clear. And so you can do, one thing at that level is only jumping into this zone of active speciation where it becomes hard. Okay? And this zone can be pretty big. So you can think of examples of groups that are in the gray zone. So groups of organisms, even like some of the key ones we talked about in the class, that are in this gray zone where they seem like they have separate species, they have a different color, they occur in different habitats, they have different food, and yet they can still interbreed. Yep. What else? Right, so cichlids. So I have a student who's working on the cichlid radiation, and they can all basically interbreed with each other. It's crazy. Right, so they have these very different morphology, and yet they're pretty compatible, and this leakage, with hybrids being formed, and things like that. So this is just like one species that has a ton of crazy forms, or is it, 20 species? Okay. And so we consider it multiple species, right? But you make the case that, we're actually still in this zone, it's not all the way to species yet. Okay, what else?
some fungi from different continents.
Mm-hmm. Fungi, you can have, you know, this spore dispersal from old world to new world, and that you can have them breeding. And actually, the people here are working on that as part of a grant from the federal government. Okay. Many plant groups. So between different species of oaks is interbreeding. Okay. talk a little bit about sunflowers, right? The hybrid vigor, and the heterosis. That's a little bit of interbreeding, right? Salamanders in California are interbreeding with a different species. And so there's lots and lots of examples of things that are in this gray zone. Okay, why do we care? Yes, there's grayness out there. Bother having the fight. Mm-hmm. Right, so the fact that there is this gray area makes things hard for biologists. Identifying the field, why is that relevant? Why do I care about that?
Surveys to see
Yeah, so we conserve like U.S. Endangered Species Act, right? We conserve species or evolutionary significant units for the vertebrates. And so do I have, you know, one red ant thing out there? Do I have a whole bunch of different species that are each adept to different areas? Right, so being able to figure out what the species limits are is important. Good. Why else might it be important? So they don't care about conservation. That's not why we care about identifying things, species, and I just want to understand how things are working ecologically, right? If I know that these are two different things that aren't interbreeding, then I help understand, oh, how do they maintain these two different phenotypes and these two different resource use spectra? Right? Because there's no interbreeding, there's no intermediate for these separate species. Yep, good. What else? Yeah, so identifying invasive species. First of all, just like, you know, here's this green plant growing over our house. I don't know what it is. It's hard to say, oh, it's kudzu, and here's, you know, here's data about how to kill it. Right? And actually, there's been a problem with introducing, sometimes people do biological control. I don't know what that is. Right, so he's one non-invasive species to take care of another. It's biological warfare, right, on nature. And so... I mean, the problem with invasive species is they reproduce, right? If I just dropped, you know, plutonium somewhere, it'd poison the ground, it'd be awful, and, you know, thousands, tens of thousands of years would be terrible, right? We'd stay in that area or disperse slowly, right? Whereas I drop, you know, a seed of an invasive plant, it can keep spreading and spreading and spreading and evolving, right? It's exponential growth. and so one way to fight them is to bring in something else that also has exponential growth, another species. Right? So you have a plant that's not being controlled by herbivores, you could bring in a specialist herbivore to try to kill it. Okay. and a few times when that's been tried, they actually brought in the wrong species. They misidentified the species. They brought in something that ate other plants instead. which isn't good. Right? So now instead of one invasive species, I have two. Right? I still have no good control of my first invasive species. Right? So it's something where it's good to know exactly what you're dealing with. What else? What about communication between scientists? Yep. Help you store information about biology, right? As they can say, okay, you know, Orsinus orca, you know, has this behavior, right? They'll, you know, beach themselves to get seals, or they'll eat whales, or they'll do this thing. And so if someone else who says, oh, look at that black and white thing in the water doing something funny to the other whale, you know, they can know what it is and look up the information.
It sounds like
one's
an educated scientist,
not
just
a well, a lot of scientists are beach bugs, professional beach bugs. that's why I know. Right, so that sort of communication is very important too, which you can do by having precise language with things. Okay, but then again, it makes it hard if you have a gray area, because like, you know, orcas, we know there are these three different groups of orcas, so maybe you need to be able to say which subgroup it is, maybe more precise than species. Okay. So one question is, you know, for taxonomists, they'll say, okay, here's a group of oaks I see outside. I want to say how many species there are, right? And so this is the problem of probably different individuals. I could lump them, you know, this way, or I could lump them this way, or I could lump them, you know, this way, right? And so a given number of individuals, there are a lot of ways of splitting them, right? So for, you know, just these 30 samples, there are 34 trillion ways to divide them into three species. you know, in practice, scientists don't look at all 34 trillion ways, right? What I try to do is figure out, you know, what are the big groupings here? You know, do I have these, what are the clumps? And then I can see something about the, you know, evolutionary nature of the clump, the way to figure out what the lineage is. Okay. and, you know, total number of ways to divide them. Okay, so there's just three species, you have one, two, three, four, five. There's this number. So it's an Avogadro's number. A lot of ways to divide it. Okay. And so scientists have various techniques we use to do this. Also, there's, you know, heuristic ways we do this too. So now we have computer programs that can help us with this. People have been dividing things into species for many, many years without using the software. Right? You can say, okay, here I see these two clumps. These have this sort of hair. These don't have this sort of hair. Go somewhere else. Up, yep, I see the same difference there too. Okay. one thing scientists use to see if to test some of these species is distinctness and symmetry. What does that mean? So symmetry. No, so, I mean, you might be thinking of symmetric speciation, just like sympatry itself, what does that mean? Yep. Yeah, they're in the same place. Yep, so they're in the same place, and so if they're distinct in the same place, so they have members of both groups in the same place, they don't seem to be interbreeding, right? That suggests that they're not interbreeding, right? Or they have them in the same, when they come to the same area, they start mixing, it's just they're not becoming isolated. The problem,
This is a question we can kind of get back, but can you talk about the orcas?
Uh-huh.
The orcas, since they don't communicate, like, since they don't communicate with groups, then they're not going to be breeding with one another. Would they be considered species, separate species, or separate subspecies, or what? Because they're reproductively isolated, but when you force them, like, seaboard, they don't care.
So, I mean, so they do have different dialects, and they keep to their own groups. It's not clear that there's no gene flow between them. Right? That's her question. So you can imagine you have, you know, an orphaned calf, one is around and then joins a pod.
Okay.
So if that happens, maybe it learns something about it. There's actually a study came out this week showing that orcas kept with dolphins start making some dolphin calls. So they actually learn. It's not clear whether they're just sort of imitating the sounds or actually saying, hey, Larry, in Larry's language. But they can pick up new calls. And so it could be that if you have something orphaned, it could learn the calls of this other group. Right? Or, you know, or it could be other ways where you could have occasional gene flow between them. So, but if there were none, then yeah, it should be split. Yeah. and, you know, it's been studied like African elephants, right? When you go to the zoo, you see African elephants and the Asian elephants. And I think there's multiple species of African elephants. So it's been split. And so, you know, that's what they've done, discovered all the time. Another example is chimps and bonobos we talked about, right? So until 1928, we thought they were the same species. They kept the same zoo pens and everything. And they're very different in behavior, right? Bonobos have a matrilineal culture, chimps don't, maternal culture. Their social interactions are different, so bonobos resolve conflict by sex, chimps resolve conflict by fighting. So they're very different cultural systems. we didn't even recognize that they were separate species until 1928. And so you can think, okay, well, you know, humans have trouble recognizing different fungal species because, like, oh, they smell different and interact with humans. But we don't think of it that way. Chimps, bonobos, and their close relatives. And even there, we had trouble until recently. Other questions about this? Yeah? I don't know if they I bet they breed in different, I'm not sure. They're very closely related. Yeah. In the wild, they're separated by a large river. And so, not much opportunity for reinforcement. If you have close related things, you might have Dove-Jansky Muller compatibilities evolve. We talked about the DMIs evolve. But also, if you find that there's some of those, and then the hybrids are less fit, then the species are in selection for avoiding interbreeding. Right. So those that have a different call do better if they don't waste their time with ones that have less fit offspring. Right. But if you have no opportunity for that, there might not be selection for that reinforcement. Yeah, you might have some DMIs, but there's been no selection otherwise to keep them from interbreeding. The wild might be interbreed, but yeah, zoos and stuff, that's crazy.
Do the chimps, like,
what's
the difference?
I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. Absolutely. I'm sure that's known, I just don't know.
Okay.
So, the most common way of doing this is, you know, biological, most common definition people say they believe in is the biological species concept. Right? And so one thing you could do is you could, you know, take a large group of males and females, yeah, I don't know what the species are here, and you could mate them, okay, and so this one can mate with this one, this one can mate with this one, this one can mate with this one and that one, right? You'll find cases like this where this one can mate with this one and have this. Right? This one can mate with this one and have this. Right? and so it can be sort of a fuzzy idea of, you know, maybe they don't do that in nature, but they could do that in captivity. So this sort of experiment to this limited species, you know, might not apply well to nature. Okay? But we do it. So things like Drosophila, we can try mating them in the lab. Right? Real problems might there be with doing breeding studies like this in the lab to the limit species. Yeah. So, what problems could there be in testing whether these are two different species or one species by trying breeding in the lab or in the zoo? So, you know, we can test in this bizarre lab environment related to breed, but in nature they might not come in contact with each other, right? it might socially, you know, I live in the highlands, you live in the lowlands, so we don't meet or things like that. Yeah. Right. So we might have to try the next generation breeding too, which could take a while if you have a long row of species. Yep, good.
Also, with a lot of things, you're going to use a lot of things
Right. And so, yeah, I mean, so there's the genetics basis of speciation, but also animals do learn from their parents, right? And there's lots of examples of this. So, like, birds pick up songs from their parents, right? And so if you have a weird environment that they're developing in, you might not get those cues. Yep. What else? Are blue whales and fin whales the same species? Let's do a breeding study in the lab. That would be hard. Yeah, so this is going to be difficult. Yep. Yep. The awesome for birds. It could also be the opposite problem, right? Where, you know, if you take pandas, right? So they didn't reproduce in captivity until fairly recently, in the 70s, right? And so, you know, you might think, okay, pandas, each individual forms its own species because they don't agree with anything else, right? Which obviously is not true. And so there's that, you know, so you could artificially lump things together that breed in captivity, but may artificially split things that don't breed in captivity but do breed in the wild. Okay. So we're trying to limit species. We have this idea of reproductive isolation. We often don't, you know, have mates to try to test this. Okay, so what could we do instead? I talked about one thing. But there's distinctness and symmetry, right? So we go out and look at nature and see if they're in the same place, we don't need to breed, probably a good species. What else can we do to figure this out? Yeah, so we can look at distinctness and symmetry as a measure to see if things are different species or not. What other data could you bring to bear on the question of, you know, are these two groups the same species or different species? Well, how, you know, you bring to labs one thing, probably won't work well in all cases. What else could you do? Genetic testing, what sort? Yeah. Yep. So about how, you know, horses and donkeys, when they have sterile offspring because of the different number of chromosomes. Right? So you could look at the chromosomes, you know, cells from the right stage of mitosis, wash them, look at them, update them, and there's chromosomes. Good. What else? So what question, so you could use genetics, right? So what question would you, like, so what measure would be interesting for you for that? Not FST or anything like that, but what sort of process are you trying to estimate to see the different species? Okay, similarities. Why is that relevant? They're all very similar to each other, then, you know, how do you maintain that similarity through time? Or probably through them interbreeding. Like, otherwise, they're just gradually diverge. Yep. What else? What about gene flow? Would that be relevant to this question?
Yes.
Yeah. Right. So if I have, you know, a species in the Arctic, a species in, you know, Argentina, right? There's no gene flow. I know that. There's some sort of term that migrates. Right. But what if they're, you know, neighboring species? I have a species in the Smokies, a different species of spruce in the Smokies. What measures of gene flow help there? Yeah. You think so? Why? Right, so if you disperse there, yep, and then what? How would gene flow be relevant in looking at species of plants in these monkeys? Measures of gene flow. Okay, if there's a lot of gene flow between two groups, what would that suggest to you? Mm-hmm. Right, so there's lots of gene flow, you know, they're not two different species, they're ongoing gene flow. I can compare, you know, the gene flow between Alabama fans and, you know, Tennessee fans, right? I mean, there's no gene flow right now, but over the long term, there's gene flow, right? And so they're different, they're one group of humans. Now, what if there's no gene flow? Very low gene flow, what would that suggest? Speciating or have already speciated. There's very, very low gene flow, but they're already meeting the criteria of, you know, not integrating anymore and that sort of thing. So they're going to diverge. These are pictures that were Creative Commons licensed, or CC0 licensed, actually. Yeah. But still, you know, big cats that can breed. Yeah. You don't have to rip off a copyright. Okay. But, I mean, if you were doing this study in nature, you don't know that, you know, this tan thing is the same as this tan thing. This black thing is the same as this tan thing, too.
Yeah.
So, you might not have the ratio. One of the measures people have been doing is the genealogical species concept, right? Where you look for groups where there's clades in the tree for many genes. Okay, so, you know, through populations we see, you know, we see interbreeding things like that, but once there's no more interbreeding, right, none of these coalesce to be all have one common ancestor. We'll talk about coalescence a little bit. So, you know, all of us in this room, just think about, you know, our mitochondria, right? We all got them from our moms, right? Now, presumably no one in this room is full sibs, right? So, pre-generation, you know, all of us have independent parentage of mitochondria, and so forth, many generations, right? But at some point, two of us share an ancestor, right? Way, you know, 10 generations ago. And then, you know, more time, and two others might share an ancestor. Right? They go back far enough, you know, we'll all share an ancestor. Go back. Right? So all our lineages will have coalesced at some point in time. And does it mean that, you know, humans originate with one species, one individual? No. Right? There could be multiple individuals at this point, right, with, you know, descendants of their own, just by chance, you know, due to finite population size, eventually the lineage descended from these died out, and the lineage from this one persisted, right? But for other genes, we could have gotten them from this one, like that, right? But at a given locus, you're going to have everything coalesce into one parent. You don't need a combination for that. Okay? And, you know, this, if our group were the entire population of humanity going forward, right, you know, at some point, you know, this one might have two offspring, this one have none, right? And so then this lineage is wiped out from population, and so forth through time until maybe this one is the ancestor for all the future ones for that mitochondria, right? So the coalescence process keeps continuing. Right, and so, for example, if you know these lineages are wiped out, the most recent common ancestor in this one, the most recent common ancestor would be this one, not this one. Right, so it keeps changing through time as things go extinct. Okay, but the idea is once you have two different populations that aren't interbreeding anymore, eventually each one will become monophyletic. Okay, and this species method looks for instances of where you see that monophyletic. So you could do something like, here are all these different gene trees, and we find that this species is not might be a good species. Okay? These are called data species and data para species. Okay? This doesn't mean, and the appeal of this sort of approach is that rather than to go out in nature and you know see, okay, are these hairs the same or not? Where do these live? Do they have evidence of gene flow? You just make bunches of the phylogenies of the genes, get a consensus, and look for the species. It's a very fast way of limiting species. Okay. The problem with this is it takes a very long time to get this coalescence for all genes. So for mitochondria, it's pretty fast. That's the probability of having to pick up a monophyly, so having to replace different species. It happens fast for mitochondria, you know, slower for one nuclear gene, slower to have five nuclear genes do it, slower to have all 15, 25, all of them, thousands, a very long time. Right? The criterion is, you know, having this reciprocal monophyly for all genes, it would take a long time. Another people look at, whether you can choose one species or two species, is looking at how similar they are. Right? And so if we find that within species, I see this much variation. Right? So we took any random two people from this room. And if we're, you know, on average, you know, 40% of us are one unit apart, so two units apart, and so forth. Right? And I take, you know, random human and a random chimp and find that we're, you know, this distance apart. Okay, so these two things we think are good distinct species. then go out and find just two random things and say, how different are you? If you're in this range, okay, maybe you're different species. If you're in this range, maybe you're the same species. This is known as DNA barcode. Okay. And so for those of you using birds, people know species really well because birders love counting species. They have their life lists and things like that. And so they really care about getting species right. And if anything, they tend to oversplit, right? So I have two species of robin, and I can check off two species. I have one species of robin. So they're going to be biased towards oversplitting. And even so, even with some sandpipers, they found these two look like they were lumped into one species, actually have a pretty deep convergence. Which suggests actually there's two species here that haven't recognized. So maybe they occur in different habitats, maybe they had different breeding songs, something like that. But, they're as separate as suggest that you're actually different species. So the advantage of this sort of approach is you can find out, you know, identify cryptic species. There's a great example of this with butterflies in Costa Rica, where they had done these careful rearing studies. They take caterpillars and they see what plants they're on, they raise them to adults, and they can see what the adults are. Okay? And the adults are all one species. and they used this sort of approach and found out, oh, looks like there should be 10 species here. That's kind of weird. And they went back and looked at the caterpillars, and the caterpillars had the characteristic differences and also had differences in the plants they ate. Seems like there actually were, you know, these 10 good species they had missed until they used this sort of approach. But this approach also has its downsides. Okay. A still common approach, though, is morphological alpha taxonomy. Okay. This is some work done by one of my advisors, who's an ant taxonomist. Okay. And so, we're going to talk about what types are. Who knows what a type is? Okay, what's a type? Yeah. It's the one used, it may not be the first one, but it's often like a really good clean specimen. But yeah, it's a specimen used as the example of this is what a Homo sapiens is. Right? Why is that useful? That's what you're looking for. Yeah. Can you test compare against is? Also, what happens if you have split a species, right? So we thought chimps are one species, chimps and bonobos are one species, and then we split them into the chimps and the bonobos, right? Which one of those groups gets the name chimps? How did you decide that? It's whichever one the type specimen's in. The type specimen for chimpanzee, whichever of those subgroups it's in becomes chimpanzees, and the other group it's not in becomes bonobos. So it prevents that sort of flipping on which is which. But then, here's sort of how these are limited with morphology. Right? So you say, okay, here I have these species or close relatives. The difference from these other species in things like size and shape of the pineal, shape of the subperiodontal process, cultural details, and how hairy they are. And so the seal is sort of arbitrary, that's splitting hairs. Splitting by hairs. That's right, right? But the thinking here is that by knowing a group well, you can say, okay, I see these species, these other species that occur in sympatry, are definitely different species, and have this much difference morphologically. I have the other things that are different areas, I see that same amount of difference morphologically, I think they're different species for that reason. Okay. So a lot of taxonomy is still done this way. Okay. Maybe now supplemented by DNA. Say, okay, this is actually quite a different. Okay. Here's an example of a type specimen. Right. So, you know, this species. This is the type. This is the specimen that is, you know, the example of the species. Okay? So, we don't think about like species having, you know, been discovered now where it's done. Right? It's actually still very active. So here's new species discovered over time. What do you see about this? Sort of trends. Is it going up or down? It's down a bit recently compared to the right point here. Well, I mean, this is, you know, like 12,000 species per year being described. It fluctuates a lot. World wars are bad. No more war, we have to describe more species. but we see it definitely fluctuating a lot, it's still pretty high. People are still describing new species now. And some of it is a sort of, you know, oh, this thing we thought was one species is actually two. Some of it is also like, whoa, look at this weird thing I found in the deep sea. That's a new species. That's a mixture of both of those things. So you could go out and discover new species, you know, in non-historical. Any questions about that? Okay. There's also lumping. So you can also take things that you thought were two species, or actually one species, to find out, oh, they're interbreeding. It's just different color morphs, something like that. You can lump things that way, too. Okay. Another part of taxonomy is this rank system. Which also matters, right? So we talk about mammals. Right? So we have mammals being a group, so we had to name them as a group. Okay. And there's rules for this stuff too. So there's rules for naming species, also rules for naming genera and family, things like that. The problem is there are different rules for different groups. Right? And so in a group, we can't use the same name for something. Between groups, we can. So for example, here's Rhaecidae and here's Congeners. Seem like they would be congeners, right? So pretty similar. Because they are. Because the same genus can be used in two different codes without causing a problem. Well, without being prohibited. It can cause problems, of course. Yeah. I think actually they do interact, but I'm not sure, which is even crazier. Yeah. But a lot of these homonyms aren't the dragon groups you see. This is a cool name. Let's name it. Yeah. Okay. Another issue is what the ranks should be, right? So if I said to you mammals, you know mammals are a group, right? What rank are they? Are they class? Are they family? Are they in order? You can tell me the traits of mammals, right? You don't know what rank they are. Right? And so one group has been arguing that what we need to do is name clades, which pretty much everyone does now. We can ignore the whole rank thing. Okay? So I can say I can name, Orchidaceae are this group. Right? It doesn't matter whether they're a family or an order, they're orchids. Here are the traits of them, so I can morph it, et cetera. Okay, this is known as phylocode. And there you name things based on the taxonomic relationships. You say, the most recent common ancestor of A and B and all descendants represent mammals. So I could say, the most recent common ancestor of spiny anteater, kangaroo, and humans is what mammals are. And then if I find a new thing, I can put it on a tree and say, oh, nope, your sister's not, you're not a mammal, or oh, you're within that, you're a mammal. That's what I talked about in the future. Or I can do ichthyology. The first ancestor of chicken that has feathers is a bird. Right? So that'd be a clade, right? And it's also based on trait. It would include things like, possibly two rats as a bird. You're good at it, you're done. Okay. One thing this prevents is fights over name changes based on rank alone. Right? So here, these two studies agree the exact same tree, the same phylogeny of life. But here we call this a family, this a family, this a suborder. Now if you change it in rank, then we call this a subfamily, this a family. They change some of the names too. Right? The argument for phylocode is, why are we fighting about this? This is called, one calls a gamete, call it gamete, call it gamete, call it that, and then you change, that same structure is maintained. You don't have to fight over. Is it a family or subfamily? Yeah. Well, there's still lots of scope for fighting.
Yeah.
This is science. but it eliminates some of the fights. So, for example, here's one recent fight. Let's skip ahead a little bit. Okay, so Anolis. We talked about Anolis, right? And so a paper in 2012 said, let's take the genus Anolis, let's go into 8 genera. And so, that first of all involves having to change some of the names, right? So, it changes from masculine to feminine name, based on Latin ending, it changes species name to a Greek. So it causes these name changes for this rank change, which is confusing. And also causes people to have fits, right? So, in this one change going from one genus to multiple genera, and during all this reports about, should we do, no, it's one genus, one gen, right? right, and fight back and forth. And the problem with fighting over ranks is that there's no scientific way to resolve this. You can't go and test, you know, scientifically, is this a genus or not? As long as they're all clades, somebody say, okay, no, this is, you know, this should not be called a genus, this should be called a genus. Right? This is an arbitrary human ranking, right? And so the advantage of phylocode is that it eliminates that sort of fight. Right? This fight, is it a genus or not? You're fighting about, is it a genus, is it a clade or not, but not, is it a genus or not? Right? Let's skip ahead. Actually, it was further back. But one thing about phylocode is that no one's really using it. And it's sort of an idea that's sort of a cool idea. It hasn't taken off yet. No, it's... we have to... Well, we're already grouping in clades. There was a fight that was won by people who should group in clades. But there's also... Once you say, okay, I think we should name birds as a clade. Well, what is the bird's clade? So right now, birds are, you know, we have a type specimen and some description of what we think that group is, but not based on, you know, it's this ancestor and this ancestor, right? So you have to convert those names into phylocode names by saying, you know, I think it requires these species, or it has to be, you know, chicken plus its feathers or something like that, or chickens plus feathers plus flight. And so you have to convert all those names, and so they're working on converting those names, but it hasn't, it's going slowly. Well, we have to, because I find a new thing. I find some feathered flying reptile in China, right? Is that a bird or not? Oh, I mean, right, okay, well, here. Right, I mean, it helps for us, like, in class, we help us get, oh, birds, rather than clade 51. Oh, then clade 51 is. Ah, that, those things. And so having names just helps humans communicate, right? Other questions about this? Yeah, and there's things like, you know, arguments over priority. So even the codes, you know, so sperm whale, right? Which name is proper for sperm whale? And depending on which different authorities, they disagree. And the cool thing about this example is that you can go to Wikipedia, which isn't a taxonomic authority by any means, but has taxonomists fighting. And you can actually see them fighting over it in real time. Yeah. So, you know, the world is considered so basically it's your Bible, well, you know. And it's a little more extreme than taxonomy usually is. But not that much more extreme. We're good to go. And again, the reason we fight over these things is not only because it's fun to fight, but also because it helps our understanding of the world, right? So, there's no, and to communicate, we need to communicate clearly, right? So, if you're talking about Physeter macrocephalus and I'm talking about Physeter catodon, right, we don't know that we're talking about the same thing. So, resolving this is useful. Oh, that's the time zone. Yeah, it's not poor people chatting either. Okay. Yeah. Well, right. No, it's just which name is the correct name for it. But, I mean, yeah. And at least for this, I mean, the codes say that there's a correct answer for this, and we can go and argue and have a fight and have a trial and agree. But for things like, you know, are anomalous one genus or the eight genera, right? Depending on, both ideas can be valid in literature. So I could have my thing, I could write a paper with eight genera, and no one could say that's wrong, taxonomically. You could have one genus, and that's not wrong, taxonomically. As long as you're following the rules, you still have this fight going on. And that comes with sort of a cultural thing of which concept wins. So, yeah, it's, as a way of organizing life, it's not perfect. That's how life is organized. It's also how people work in its pieces. No, I'm not a good enough taxonomist, too. All right, I'll see you on Monday.